DJ Tony Drake.
This is DJ Tony Drake, a.k.a. Mr. Top Shelf himself, and right now, you're in tune to Your World News, where journalism and activism are not mutually exclusive, here on yourworldnews.org.
My name is Golda Boone. I'm one of the ones who didn't listen. I've been in prison 14 years. This record ain't no joke. Learn the dispense of our sorrow. And don't end up in the belly of the beast. Mr. Gilman, the judge and the
pain, there's no peace. I'm living in the belly of the beast.
I was at Central Park when Nike passing through, when I see my big brother with his crazy crew. So he came down on me and said, what's up with you? I tried to take a piece, probably wouldn't turn it loose. The only reason why I didn't go out hard, cause my brothers in the front, I would've took them apart. So they moved, and I burned his crew. And that was really f***ed up, what I had to do. But that's how it was, not meant to be. But they had my brother stuck out on so many keys. So I brought this message so you can see. And that's how I got in the belly of a beast.
I used to have a name, but now I got a number. I used to put something 6 feet under. Now I'm in jail, no longer a rebel. Can't tell me damn thing about the ghetto. I've been there.
Life.
I have been there sitting in skid street. I'm fighting.
should have listened.
Welcome to another edition of Critical Insight on Your World News. I'm your co-host, Solomon Kamajan, and today we're joined again by Dr. Joseph Richardson, you know, professor at University of Maryland and chair of the African-American Studies Department. And this is in collaboration with Liberated Perspectives at Nimbrew Cultural Center. And today we've got another fantastic show. I say it each time, but we have some real special guests that I remember from my childhood. I had the tape, you know, before CDs. I remember when the tape came out, Lifers Group. That's the video that if you're watching this recorded, you know, you just saw the video Belly of the Beast. That was the first track I heard and it was banging. And as you know, you just saw it. So today we're joined by Almighty L, La-Di-Da, B-Wise, Amazing G, and Chuck X of the Lifers Group. And we may have some other members of the Lifers Group join us as the show goes on. But brothers, it is a pleasure to have you on the program. And I just want to hit the ground running. Can you tell us how did you guys start the Lifers Group? Where did you meet? And how, you know, what was the origins? And how did the group come together in the first place?
Yeah.
Well,
I got a G. back in like 1990, 91, you know, when I was in Rahway State Prison, you know, I was around, I think, 17 years old at the time. I was 17. I was waived as an adult, you know, as a juvenile, but I was in Rahway State Prison. And we was aware that they had the Square Street program and things going on at that time with the Lifers Group program. I'm sure a lot of you could remember that. The Scare Straight thing that they showed the documentary with them. When we got there, it was like, you know, in the 90s. So around this time, you know, hip hop, you know, was on the come up. So, you know, us being young and coming into jails, you know, again, you know, we have seen the Scare Straight programs and things of that nature. And, you know, and our thing back then was, you know, if you wanted to get a message across to the youth in this day of time, you know, it was done through hip hop, like through music back then. So we had this idea that we took to Harvey George at the time, who was the president of the Lifers Group. And we told them, like, you know, if y'all wanted to, you know, get your message across right now, you know what I mean, how they go about doing this through hip hop, you know, what's going on down in the street, because a lot of the guys in the Lifers Group have already been locked up, you know, over a period of time, like 10 years or more when I got there. You know what I mean? At the age of 16, 17 years old. So it was an idea that we just brought to their attention. You know, Harvey George, I guess, took it to the Lifers Group members. And, you know, they contacted some people. And, you know, they got back with us. and we did an audition around the institution. And, you know, we picked out at the time, you know, the best rappers. You know, and that's how we formed the Life and Group Rappers, you know, because the Life and Group was already there. They, you know, they've been formed since, I believe, the early 70s or something of that nature. 76. I'm not sure that.
1976.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. So, you know, we came in at the Life and Group Rappers. And again, Maxwell Melvin, who was the vice president at the time, you know, Harvey George, again, who was the president, took it to him. And I guess, you know, he, you know, they got in contact with some people, Hollywood bases and things of that nature. You know, they brought in some guys. They flew in from L.A. and things. And the rest is history. We formed the Lifers Group and, you know, put the work together, you know, and put this message together, you know, out to the youth. You know what I mean? You know, about our lives, you know, and the trials and tribulations and things that we've been through. And if you're dealing in life of crime, these are the results.
Right.
True.
Joe?
So that's how, you know, it all really started. It all started as just like, you know, us coming up with this idea, because that what we was into when we got there, you know, in the early 90s, hip hop.
When did you start seeing that it was having an impact?
Well, you know what I'm saying? For me personally, Almighty L, like I was a person that actually helped out on the Scare Street tours and stuff like that with the kids. And as I was talking to different like kids and things of that nature, I started seeing them saying, yo, you know, like you the guy from the rap video or whatever. And then, you know, they was like, you know, and, you know, it was kind of like fascinating to actually realize that what I said from the heart, what I experienced from the heart, and like what we had did as a group was actually being conveyed to society. So right there, that was like an amazing feeling for me. And then, you know, like I was able to go over and talk to different kids and things of that nature, because we was also rapping, but we was also doing a Scare Street with the kids, because myself and Amazing G came in there like 16 with grown men in the state prison. So like we had found each other because we was in a youth house, and you know, we were basically on the same track, you know what I mean? And we had just went through the same journey Rose. Together. Mm-hmm. And you know, so like we was actually youth in that type of situation that they will be in if they do not listen. If you do not listen, they always want to have a place for you to go. They will find a place to put you. All you got to do is look at what just happened in Pennsylvania, where they caught two judges mm-hmm. doing cash for kids. Mm-hmm. Two judges, cash for kids, taking $1 million deposits to send people's kids, regardless of the crimes, to jail. And it only blew up because this, and no disrespect to nobody, but a Caucasian kid, he sent him, and his mom went ballistic. And that whole thing got blew up. See, we rap, we are also conscious, and we are definitely on top of what's going on in society.
No doubt. I mean, because this lottie die. No doubt, I mean, because the prison industry is a billion-dollar industry. That's the, you know, to connect what Almighty L talking about. I mean, it's like the politicians. I mean, if they don't, I mean, they have to fill these prisons, these cells up when they talk about privatizing prisons. I mean, it's the politics. They be lobbying to keep the laws stringent. I mean, because if you can't lock nobody up, you can't fill them cells, then the business can't go on. We're talking about a billion-dollar business. Whereas now, like, before, when we was in prison in the 90s, your family could send you the food packages, your family could send you clothes, your family could send you all like the amenities that you needed. But now they monopolize it. You can't get nothing unless it's contracted by some corporation where they send you the TVs, they send you the fans, they send you the word price, they send you everything. So it's monopolized. It's a business, you know, it's a billion-dollar business, and this is how it is connected. So therefore, like with the politicians, aspect is like, you know, y'all got to keep them laws like, you know, stringent enough so that we could just lock them up for anything to fill them prisons. And this is why, when you look at it, when the Caucasian, there's no need to apologize, Almighty. I mean, the reality is there is a disparity going on in the prison industry, in the judicial system. I mean, that's what it is. It took for a Caucasian to go through it, you know, and his parents who may be connected with, you know, these politicians like that, blow it up. But when it affects only the black and brown people, there's no problem. So that's the problem. We don't apologize for what's real and what's factual.
No apology necessary. I really appreciate that. It's as people will call it, New Jim Crow. They call it slavery by another name. And as you brothers know, you know, many people go in there for, you know, and Dr. Joseph Richardson, you know, because he teaches this, knows, you know, very well that a lot of people go in there for non-violent offenses, but because the conditions are so inhumane, you know, they, you know, it turns them, you know, very violent really quickly. And so my question I wanted to ask you, what are the living conditions like? What were the living conditions like? How were you treated? You know, if you were conscious, like all you brothers are very conscious, you know, were you persecuted? You know, if you tried to spread the gospel of wisdom, knowledge of self.
Absolutely. So we are African-American men that made the mistake of whatever crime we committed, and they step on you from the beginning. First of all, let me just give you a description. County jail is 5 in a county cell, maybe 6. People sleeping near the urinals where you piss at, okay? Okay, then you go to, you know, like the next phase, which is, you know, where they're going to, you know what I'm saying, send you at. Where they going to send you at? Reception. So now you're around all these different people, and now you stripped away from your family because you were shipped somewhere maybe miles and miles away from your family. So now you either got a call, put all that pressure on somebody to have money on there just to talk to your kids and all them things of that nature, or to get transportation there. And then after that, now you go even further someplace to a prison where you are, first of all, you are policed by Caucasian guys, man, that literally let you know who they are. Like, I was literally called the nigger by a sergeant. You know what I mean? He called me a fat nigger. And I was like, I couldn't believe it because I had never seen racism face to face before. But when I seen that, I already knew what it was. And people was acting like this was a real plantation, man. Like, people were scared to talk. You know, you couldn't look at the white women and all that thing of that nature, when you could look at anybody you want, but they take full advantage of any privilege they can, man. You know, they strip you, make you bend over, cough, all this crazy inhumane stuff they still practicing. It's to strip us of our dignity.
Like they did during shadow slavery.
And to add on to what Almighty L was just saying, because, you know, we both in Camden County. A few years ago, they just had a big lawsuit and stuff, the way they was treating the guys in Camden County. And what he said was, they was just putting guys in 7-day lockdown. Sometimes you stay longer. Just stuff you in a cell. You come on a unit, they give you a cot till you find a room. You had guys getting beat up. You know what I mean? And they put you in a room with guys that was cool and didn't want you in there. So it was crazy. Had, like he said, guys sleeping on the floor. They feed you like 3-4 in the morning and a clock. Like, you wake up, your food on the floor. You don't know, somebody did something to it. You may wake up, your food not there. They didn't care, you know, because it's all about filling up a bed. It's all about, you know what I mean, that bag. It's a business. You know what I mean? So it was just a big lawsuit where they had to pay for that. They was guys coming in for tickets. They'll put them in a cell where a guy just killed somebody. Guys coming in for parole violators. They still putting them in red suits, maximum security, putting them in cells with guys that might be loony psychos. So it was a lot going on that shouldn't have been happening. That was, you know what I mean, happening inside these jails, especially a lot of these private owned prisons where the, you know, Biden said now he's no longer funding them. But look into the, how these private prisons is. It's slavery. They got a person working all day for 47 cents. You doing an 8-hour job for 47 cents.
And it's on the stock, and it's on the stock market.
Exactly. So you know, coming through there, you know, you treat it bad. You treat it like livestock. Right. You know what I mean? You come in, they shower you, spray that stuff all in your eyes, in your face. Like he said, make you bend over, cough. You know, they say bend over and crack a smile. You know what I mean? Like it's a joke.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? They looking all up in you and stuff of that nature. So yeah, they definitely like try to degrade you and belittle you and strip you of your manhood. You know?
Right. Be wise.
Yeah. You know, like everybody's experience is different. You know what I mean? That comes through, right? Like, you know, and the prison system like changes throughout the time, like everything else. You know,
right.
Like when I came through Camden County, they wasn't mass packing people in there like that, right? They was packing some people, but depending on what type of crime you came in there for, they was putting you in a cell with, like, you might have had a cell, you might not have a cell, you know what I mean? Depending on the level of your crime, right? So, I mean, you know, and it's a little different. Like, in Philly, you know, this is the reason why you had riots, though, you know, in certain prisons, because of the food that they were serving you, because of the way that the officers would try to talk to you or try to, like in Philly, you know, they killed the warden and the assistant warden and the social worker for this nonsense, right? On some riot stuff. In Camp Hill, they burnt the whole prison down in Camp Hill. Homes and Alcatraz, right? That was about the condition. Everything is always goes back to the conditions. In Leesburg, I seen the police fighting the inmate and knock his eye out. Right? You know, on some racism time. But it's not always the white man, you know what I mean, against the black man or whatever, right? I seen black officers beat down black inmates. You know what I'm saying? And a lot of that goes by how you carry yourself, though. You know what I'm saying? A lot of it goes by how you carry yourself when you come in. Like when I came in, they ain't make me bend over and cough and all that old type of stuff. Even though I know they do that. I know they do it, right? As I've been in, they did that. But when I came in, they didn't do that. When I came in Trenton State Prison, they put me in a cell with a bunch of other inmates and took my clothes from me, telling me I had to push my clothes out, but they left me in there butt naked with all these other men. You know what I mean? I guess they thought something was going to happen, right? Something to happen. You know what I'm saying? So, I mean, everybody experience is different, right? I met racism in the state, but I met corruption in the feds. You see, it's different, whole different vibe, whole different level of action, right?
Right.
It's clearly in the state, but it's not racism just coming from the Caucasian American. It's, believe it or not, coming from your own people.
Right.
From your own kind, looking down at you, not knowing what you in there for, not knowing what Jesus is about. And so it creates tension. So it's their situation. They were certified as an adult. I was certified as an adult, just in a different state. Right. So it's just like we live the life we live from the life we choose. And a lot of times they don't know what's going on. These kids don't know what's going on. That's why when they get trapped off, then they start telling on everything and their mother. Right. Yep. When we was going through what we was going through, we knew what was going to happen because we had old heads. We don't have old heads now, though. We had old heads. We knew what was going to happen before we got in there. So we was like, oh, this is going to happen. This is going to do. We got to stand up. Right. So we stood up. But that doesn't take away from the time that you do. But once you get incarcerated, then what? You gonna play basketball all day and then lift weights? I mean, or you wanna programs they offer? Go to school, try to get a skill. Like L. Do welding. You do welding, right?
Definitely. I'm a machine mechanic, electrician. I mean, purveyors.
So he didn't waste his time. He didn't waste his time. That's just exactly what I'm talking about, right? lot of them do, and a lot of them young kids get shocked because they don't hear this message. But if we can just take one person, it's one kid. If we just touch one kid, it's like, listen, man, that ain't really the route you want to go.
Right.
I think kids hang themselves in the cell because they got shocked about the culture, the prison culture. They were shocked and they hung themselves, killed themselves, or whatever. Right. If we can just touch one kid and say, listen, this ain't the route you really want to go, man. Take, like, I've been there. Like, I'm telling you what it is, but I'm going to tell you the raw side of it. I ain't going to tell you the pretty side. I'm going to tell you the raw side. This is what it is, right? This isn't what you want to do. You know what I mean? Because one thing about education opens the doors for all types of opportunity. When you turn your back on education, you turn your back on success. On success, because you limit your options. Education allows you to have options so that you can live a life that's worth living.
Thanks. Joe?
So we see, I think that was a good point, B.Y. So we see a lot, like in Philly now, right? You got the homicide rate, is over 200 homicides this year. So how do we get to these young boys and girls right now, right, where you don't see no real rules in the street. You see more kids getting shot. You see more women getting shot, right? You got a lot of just chaos happening in the street right now. How do we get to these young kids right now before they even end up behind bars or in a car in the trauma unit?
First thing first, what a lot of us fail to realize is what happened in the last past 10 years, okay? And this is why a lot of our kids is way out of pocket, way out of control. They passed the law where you can't no longer discipline your child. And during the same time they passed that law, in the United States of America, they build over 100 and something more institutions.
That's right.
So you see the trick in that? They telling you, to raise your kids and to teach them by all means, but however they tell you can't discipline them. So how is it that you enforce what's being said? You see, I was raised up getting my ass whooped. We know, because if they didn't make us understand with words, they made us feel it. You know what I mean? They reinforced what they said. When we didn't listen, when we was hard-headed, they say hard head make a soft behind. See, it's no longer that, because they changed the rules. They made laws where parents can no longer discipline a child, only to a certain extent. And that extent is just talking. And we know how kids is. We was all once there. One going one there, out the other. So what do we have to enforce it now? Send them to their programs where they teach them, if your parent hits you, tell us. They teach them this in the schools and everything else. So now for us to discipline our child or to come at them aggressive, it's a crime. It's a problem. We're wrong. We're being abusive. See, first we have to change these laws back, because they changing these laws on us. And a lot of us not understanding. So a lot of parents is giving up because they getting in trouble for trying to discipline their child or educate their child. See, you got to know and understand, we was once beaten when we learned how to read and write.
That's right.
And we was caught doing it.
That's right.
So you got to check out the modern of it now. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
We can't teach our kids. We only can talk to them and tell them. But then force some, it's a crime now.
Hey, yo, hold on. Hold on. Something else that I like to add on to that is that they, meaning this system, meaning the racist system, is stealing our kids too, man, through diapers. Because through diapers right now, they are these girls are signing over their kids to get on medication and stuff like that, to get on vouchers and all that, signing them up to go to these schools.
Making them state babies.
Hold on. Which is a pipeline. See, these schools, these alternative schools are schools that have metal detectors. They have staff in there. They can restrain kids and things of that nature. So in reality, what they're doing is preparing them kids for the youth house, preparing them kids for the detention center, because that's the same prisons in there. And then you go on to be a you know, career criminal. You know what I mean? So we have to pay attention to diapers, man, because what diapers does too is feed, you know, people that can't have kids, whether it's same-sex marriages, all that type of stuff. You know what I mean? You know, these, like, the kids is going through a lot of stuff too, man. Our kids are being going through stuff because it's people that want our kids, man, by any means necessary, man. So we have to pay attention to them through education, through training, through proper guidance, man, and just sending them in the right direction. Because, and I'm telling you something else, you can't leave your kids with just anybody out there, neither.
Yeah.
Because your kids could be subject to things that they just not supposed to be around. So pay attention to the diaper system, because they are also beating the prison system. Because they're taking your kids, and then your kids be 100 miles away, learning whatever, going through whatever. And then from there, you know, they start getting abused, man. So that's another thing to pay attention to.
Now, what I think a main step we need to take as parents is, see, another thing that they did with this internet. See, we talk about getting back our kids. We have to get in tune with what's going on and what they doing. Because a lot of us as adults don't even know how to work computers. So how can you check behind your child? And this is what most kids are doing now. So they on these internets, they being fed all this negativity and nonsense constantly, 24/7, especially when this pandemic hit. That's all everybody done did now. Everybody's into the internet. So this is where a lot of our kids is learning a lot of this nonsense from, because there's no limitation of what they put on there. You feel me? So what a lot of parents need to start doing is start getting in tune, getting computer literate, and start learning about this new world that's going on. Because, you know, technology is constantly advancing. It's a vicissitude. You know what I mean? And it's not going to stop. Look where the Bitcoin is at today. It went from 2 cents to $57,000 a share. You feel me? So we have to grow. We have to learn. We have to get in tune to what's going on. We can't sit back and allow these people to constantly keep feeding our kids this negativity and drama. You know, I spoke in an interview, and I forget the name of the joint we did, but I spoke about how 20 years ago, where they despised gang members, now they employing them at a high time rate. Look at the videos and stuff now. What do you see on there? Our youth, our babies, our kids, $30, $50 million. What do a 17-year-old, 16-year-old know what to do with that type of money that's been gang-banging all his life, that don't listen to his parents already? And you give him $30 and $50 million, what do you expect for him to do? And he's already gang-banging. Mm-hmm. They're going to get acquit. They're going to buy more guns, more drugs, and do more what? Damage to their communities. Mm-hmm. See, so we must get into their heads. We must get out of this, everything's by the bag. We got to get out of, man, I'm just about my family, because it used to be the community raising a child. Now everybody going for self. And the only time Black Lives Matter is when a white person kill them.
Exactly.
Yeah. So let's talk about that a little bit.
You know, so we must get in tune with ourselves and see what's going on, you know what I mean, globally. We must really look at the bigger picture, because the internet right now got our kids' minds messed up. That's all they know. Anything they need to know, Google. They ask Google or Siri. They ain't even got to learn. They don't got to learn how to read, write, or nothing. All they got to do is ask their phone. It tell you anything you need to know. So it's more programming versus education.
Yeah. So what y'all think about this whole defund the police? You know, some people would say, if we defund the police and we just put everything in the social service systems, then it might be wild outside. And then some people will say, yeah, we do need to defund the police. What y'all think about that?
It ain't about defunding them. See, that's coming from a monetary perspective. Hold their ass accountable to the laws that you will hold an average citizen. You
that's right.
An unarmed person, the law apply to you. See, it's the defunded, that's not it. It's the network they got. And then the first thing they try to do, so, well, he ain't had no record. You know what I mean? So, no, excuse me, say he have a record. So that justify you killing this guy, you murdering this dude. We go all the way back to Sean Bell. They let off 50 rounds. And prior to him, they let off 50 rounds. What happened? Nothing happened. That's nothing right. happened. So that tells the police that, oh, I could murder these people and get away with it because of my affiliation, my association. You know, when you talk about right. The Rifle Club goes back to KKK. If nobody don't know, that goes all the way back. When they started the KKK, the same when they started that, the National Rifle Club, that associated. And guess who are affiliated with that? You talking about powerful, well, let's say, quote unquote, powerful people. So it's not about, it's the defunding, but it's the influence that they have. Hold their ass accountable. The chick, she pulls her gun and talk about thinking, oh, I'm going to tase you. There's a difference between the tase and the damn gun, dummy. That's the color. That I mean, when you point that, you got to see the color. But she That's know right. that she could do what she thought. She's under the impression because what has been happening where all these police is killing innocent people, or whether they got a record or not. I mean, if that doesn't justify you, oh, I could get away with this. So hold them accountable. Hold them accountable the same way you will hold someone else. I mean, it's like the same thing with Bloomberg. I mean, he wanted to, you know, this racial profile. I mean, the stop and frisk thing. I mean, you mean tell me because I'm walking down the street going to store for my mama and any average black and brown person and you, the police who's patrolling the areas, can say, well, he looks suspicious. Where the probable cause at? There is none. It doesn't exist in their mind. The probable cause is because of his color of his damn skin. You know, that's their probable cause. You see, so once you stop that, once you hold them accountable, see, this is why all this celebration going on, you know, when the chump, you know, killed the boy George Floyd.
Yeah.
I mean, everybody got to sit down and pray and hold. It's plain and clear what this guy did. He murdered this dude. So we got to sit and hold and pray to God that they come back with a guilty verdict. It's good that they did. So now you see that when you do stuff like that in public, when people pleading for you to get off this man's neck, mm-hmm. you know that it's possible you could get away, but you didn't. So now let's see what happened. My point is hold them accountable. Damn all this defunding. I mean, the money is the power, but it goes beyond the money.
Not only that, but you know, in like real world experiences, everybody that's human has good and bad inside of them. So what makes one person more like better than somebody else's? We are seeing time and time again where, you know, these cops are human people too. Like this cop, I was just looking at the news, you know, he was a sergeant or something like that, but this guy got busted with all this child like porn on his phone, man. Like,
no,
we just cannot just say, okay, this person is a cop or this person has this title, you know, so I could trust him. And I'm just going to say one more thing. As far as them cops, the only thing you got to do is make them have to get re-certified every year for their behaviors. Look over that, you know what I mean? Like, if they have any brutality cases or anything, and then that right there should determine whether they could go on year after year, because that way you can check a person versus just letting a person run wild. And I'm going to tell you another thing. You know what I mean? This thing with the Floyd Chauvin situation, if we didn't have a videotape, man, that guy would have got off. And then even with the state, if the federal charges didn't reinforce them nails in his coffin, he deserved everything he get, and he should be treated the same way that he treated that man, because you know why? Because he was in a situation of you are responsible to make good decisions. That man ain't make good decisions, man. That man
should do what he did.
Yeah, and I just want to say this real quick. I couldn't agree more. It, accountability and it's a different set of laws, you know, that they have applying to police officers. As opposed to civilians. When you kill somebody in cold blood, you should get the same. If that was any one of us killing somebody on camera in cold blood, that would be automatic murder one. And you and you remember, thank you. And you remember our brother, Oscar Grant. He was murdered on camera. And Johan Mezelis, the 6'7" BART police officer that assassinated him. He was handcuffed and he shot him in the back. That dude got, he got less than a year. He got less time than Mike Vick got for fighting dogs. He got less than a year. He's out free. The Joseph Weekly, the white police officer that, you know, and I know there are, you know, Django type, you know, black police officers that try to tap dance, that they try to tap dance for their white, you know, their white colleagues to prove, I'm good, massa. I can do the same thing. But, you know, so when I say, you know, Joseph Weekly, he was a white police officer in Detroit, Michigan, 2010. He shot, you know, a 7-year-old black girl, Ayanna Stanley Jones, and he never did a day in prison, And he's back on the beat now. He got administrative leave for a couple years, and he's back on the beat now. So I really appreciate what y'all said. And I want to ask you, the Lifers group is reuniting after three decades. Your message was powerful. I was one of those youth that listened to, you know, your tape. I got a hold of your tape. Me and my friends, we listened to your tape. It was powerful. A lot of inspiring lyrics. Now, 3 decades later, you guys are coming back. I want to ask you, is the message the same? Will you still be trying to reach out to the youth?
Wisdom, of course. And I'm going to say this as well. Thank you, man. But see, this right here reinforces that the positivity. See, good vibes, people is going to remember that, man, because as soon as you get in the jam, it's already teaching you how to think. That's all music is, man. It's a vibe that's going to teach you to think, teach you what to do in certain, situations, man. But like we are 100% for the kids, man, and we will be coming to different platforms performing. Like if you guys have anything that we can tap into, man, we are definitely available, man, for the positivity and for hip hop, man.
It's about raising the conscience. I mean, because I think I'm the least one out of all of us being interviewed that been out here a short period of time. July will be 5 years. I know they've been out longer than me. And I was, prior to that, I did 31 years in prison because I'm listening to it like we all was raised up. I was 17 years old when I, you know, got charged, you know, for my crime. They waved me up, you know. But
me too.
And I, you know, the years I was enrolled with for like 25 years, like the later years after they left, I became a member in the Lifers group, and I was doing the juvenile awareness. They just call it Scared Straight, but the juvenile awareness that we understand. And it's about raising the conscience. It's about the same thing like when L, when he was in that, involved in the young brothers recognized him, you know, as far as like being in that rap video. So it's about raising the conscience. It's about saying, look at us now. I mean, this thing is multifaceted, what we're trying to do. Because for one, we're showing them that, you know, you could come out here after doing that time, after being involved in the streets, after being involved in that life of crime, and, you know, live a positive life. L, he does his thing. I mean, I came out hitting the ground running. You know, right now I work for the city of Newark, where I reside at. You know, I told myself, I mean, and this is like, I never, ever in my life had a job. And that's not the brag. I mean, I got locked up. I was 17 years old. You know, prior to that, I was in and out, you know, the youth correctional facilities. I mean, so it's like, I know I had to do that, you know, in order to stay out, because to trade this for that, that's crazy. But it's a multifaceted thing that we're trying to do to show them that you could come out after living that lifestyle and become a law-abiding citizen. There ain't nothing wrong with that. That's nothing corny or soft about that. No, you know, it's about family, not understanding, you know, the effect of what we did to our family, our siblings, our loved ones. The family don't want to see nobody, and then how it affects them while we're in prison.
Except
a collect calls. Oh, I need money. I need food packs, stuff like that. And to show them that you could do something positive, with your life. So it's the raising of conscience. Like, I salute those who have these degrees, you know, I mean, what you doing, you know, teaching it. But I'm going to tell you, like, dealing with that, the brothers, the younger guys, they actually pay close attention to those who live that life. I mean, because I'm telling you that you don't want to be in that 6x9 cell. I'm telling you that how gangster you think you are, they're gonna tell you to strip down, like they said, they're gonna tell you to bend over. And if you don't bend over good enough, they said one sucker, you know, I don't know. I gotta see pink. Hold on, you mean you as a man, you mean tell you need to see that's the pinkness of my anus? But so regardless how gangster, how much you can bench, how big you are, they would take your humanity.
Degrading.
And you don't want that. They would take your humanity. So this is our message, bro. You don't want to do that. I mean, find something better to do. You can apply your talent. I mean, because there's a lot of brothers in prison. Once they're in prison, they know how to do tattoos. They know how to draw. They know how to box. They know how to do this. Don't wait till you get in prison to do that. Apply this stuff to yourself while you're out here. We are like that living proof to show, like, bro, you could come and do something better with your life. You don't want to go in there. It's not because you ain't soft or nothing like that, because it's not about the physical. In some way it is, because, you know, sometimes people sit in the mess hall or hang out, you know, about their sex now or what city they from. It's about, it's also a psychological warfare, because you go inside that prison and deal with the psychological things that goes on and make it out there without being on drugs, without being drugged up, without being on control things. So it's like, hopefully this is our message. This is our message that we're trying to put out. You know, I salute the brothers for doing the Life is Group official. You know, I salute the brothers, and it's an honor to be a part of that, you know, because it's that, you know, the avenue of this music where we're going to try to reach them. And it's not like, I mean, you know, look at us. I mean, you could do it, you know. So
three things I like to say, y'all. You know what I mean? One thing is, do not be afraid. First of all, my name is Almighty L, man. 209021. You know what I mean? Life is Group official. God loves the black sheep. I like to tell you three things. First of all, do not be afraid to change, man.
Exactly.
The second thing is, man, plug in to God. You know what I mean? For me, myself, Jesus Christ, man, I turned my life over to the Lord and my life began to change, man. You know what I mean? I start taking accountability for my actions, my thoughts, the people I was around. And the last thing I like to say is, God loves the black sheep. Jesus is my only Lord.
All right, to add on a bit more to the topic, I think what we first have to do is change the mindset of the youth, because what's going on now is this. You know, when we came up, you know what I mean, we paved the way for a lot of these guys that we actually misled, and we made it cool to go to jail. See, if you ain't go to jail or do all the rough stuff or get in trouble and stuff, you was a nobody. And see, now we must go back and change that mindset. What that does is, when we start out getting in trouble and first and putting ourselves in a jam, it prolongs us. It stagnates us. You know, it stunts us. That's why a lot of us don't start, you know, really getting into our adulthood until we 30 and 40 years old. You get it?
Yes, sir.
So we must change that mindset and get our kids into thinking positive first. Get educated before you mess up your life.
Exactly.
You dig yourself in a hole, and then it's going to take harder to get out. See, we must change that mindset first with the youth. It's not cool to go to jail. It's cool to go to school. It's cool to get educated. It's cool to know how to do versus sitting there not understanding what's going on around you. You know, we got to teach them first. Get an education. You know, apply yourself. You know, get involved with things, because you hear a lot of kids in the day of time with everything that's going on saying, I'm bored. Because they don't have a direct aim or focus. And see, we must help them inquire some of them things. See, a lot of us as parents now, we don't even take the time to sit down and talk to our kids no more, because everybody's so caught up in their phones. So we must, again, it's like education versus programming. Or should I say the internet or the powers that be? Because they're tricking us now, and they're giving us something to keep our mind away from what's really being, you know what I mean, done in the world. You know what I mean? They took us off of the pro-black fight the power, because they're giving us all these free games, all these PlayStation 5s, 360s, Xboxes, and things like that. They entertaining us more. They making our programs more real. You know, so we more excited and more, you know, infatuated with the programming and all the animation things that's going on over there. So we got to get our peoples back focused on what's real.
Keep swimming.
Dr. Richardson?
Nah, I just want to say I want to salute all y'all. I got to get ready to hop off, but I got like 50 million questions. I don't even know how we going to continue this conversation. I got to get y'all numbers, man. For real. I'm going to have to get y'all emails and y'all numbers from Solomon because I want to continue the conversation. I ain't even scratched the surface on what I wanted to talk about with y'all.
Right.
I appreciate everything that y'all been saying and doing. Man,
thank you.
Y'all been dropping a whole lot of jewels, and I can't wait at least for the people to see this so I can show some of the young guys that I work with, you know, this. And I was, you know, if I could suggest to y'all tell me what y'all think about it. Go on YouTube and watch Life After the Gunshot, episode 1.
Okay.
And Solomon can give y'all my email and all of that, and y'all could just hit me back. Tell me how y'all feel about it. I got a podcast, too. I want to bring y'all on it, but I want to get y'all feedback on how y'all feel about the documentary. It's a 4-part series. It's episode 1. And the next episode, this episode is on trauma, being shot, physical and psychological. But the next episode is on the carceral system, because all the young brothers that's in the documentary that's been hit, they all been locked up too. And they between the ages of like 18 and that's 24 smart, when they got hit. So
let me say one thing, brother. Just know this. We still take applications for the documentary.
Exactly.
So definitely get in touch with us.
Yeah.
Life is Group Official. Because we still taking applications for that too. Right. We doing some music and things of that nature. We working on music as we speak. We've been in the studio. We done laid 4 to 5 tracks. We back in the studio this week. But we still taking applications for the documentary. So if you're interested, contact us. We can have a sit down and do something with this. So definitely get our emails like that, and stuff, or even send us ours, and we will definitely get in contact with you, brother.
No doubt.
You're on point, G.
And we right here. We all right here in the tri-state area.
Yeah, that's say no more. That's I'm gonna get at y'all. I'm gonna get at y'all as soon as I get y'all email.
That's right, brother, and I appreciate you.
I appreciate y'all. Yeah.
Salute.
I'll see you later.
Salute. And I'm Life is Group Official.
That's right. And I'm staying on to finish this interview. And I'll be sending my application for that documentary as well, no doubt.
Okay.
Before we end this, I wanna get into your projects, and I want to ask you, do you feel you got the recognition deserved from the hip hop community and society as a whole, you know, what you contributed to the game? Because I can't tell you how much, you know, as an educator, you know, on the college level, you know, and working with youth, young people, 18, 19, 20 years of age. I mean, I can't tell you how much, you know, that your album, you know, meant to me and my friends growing up. I mean, it was powerful. And so, do you feel, I mean, you guys were Grammy nominated, which is
whoa,
bananas, you know, unbelievable. Do you feel that you've gotten the recognition from the hip hop community? Because I think you guys should be, you know, out there. I mean, I think you guys should be played on radio stations, I really do. So
I think that's why now we're making this comeback. Because honestly speaking, back then we made a strong impact, and I think now is the time for us to come back again. Because when we was out there doing what we did, you know, it changed, you know, with the times, and you know, there's a lot more stuff going on that need to be spoke about, you know, and a lot of people need to hear this. So, yeah, I do think that, you know, we got the recognition. I think now that we need to come back and make another impact, you know what I mean, to the youth out there. You know, so hopefully, you know, we will make another great impact this time around. And that's really our focus. Our focus is really, you know what I mean, to get to the youth, you know what I mean, with our music and the messages that we're trying to deliver to them. Because, again, like I spoke to the brother earlier, we have to change the mindset now, you know what I mean, of the youth and the way that they think. And so I think that our music will play a very big, important part in hip hop in this day and time.
All right, well, me, I feel as though that we didn't really receive the recognition that we were supposed to because of the fact that I think we should have been like more like embraced, but like I believe that everything happens for like a reason, and you know, like the timing is perfect because we are the perfect footprint for prison reform. Like, can't nobody tell you about prison better than a person that went through prison? Like right now, you know, I'm like sitting right here right now, and I can tell you right now that in any admissions worldwide, it smell like ammonia. It smell like a whole bunch of soap and stuff because they try to clean it up when you come in. So you get upstairs and realize they don't smell like none of that. And you know, you know, it's a bunch of jumpsuits and it's mats, these like little mats that everybody then slept on, but they spray them off so that you can think that you're getting a new product, man. So it ain't nobody better than us to tell you what needs to be done. Also, because me myself, I've been out going on 10 years, you know what I mean? I'm a certified welder, all facets, machine mechanic, conveyor, installer, electrician, you know, like I have a, you know, like a profitable job, and I got a business on the side as well, which is God Loves the Black Sheep, where I print up shirts and other apparel and things like that. So I have learned by the grace of God, you know what I mean, that you have to plug in. See, you got to humble yourself. Because if you run around here in a panic all the time, talking and, you know, all this, you ain't being still enough to realize, yo, somebody's talking to you, man. And then I realized who it was. For me, that's for me. And I've been successful. And, you know what I mean? I'm around success. All my brothers right here that's like in the group, all of us is doing something productive. All of us is afloat, doing our thing, and positive examples of what can be if you humble yourself and listen, because everybody had to humble themselves to listen to somebody. Because either you gonna listen to somebody out here or you gonna listen to somebody in there. You exactly. Make your choice.
Facts.
And then facts. You know, it's about networking. Just I mean, it's like, you know, doing this interview and, you know, the people that's connected, you know, with, you know, Life is Group Official, want to do this interview, the brother teacher college, you know, and what you do, you know, it's like that. And then not only that, it's like we are in a better position, you know, to like oversee and control our musical works. I mean, like me, you know, Lottie Dot, I came in late on a project. I wasn't in Belly of the Beast. You know, it was like once Living Proof was being done. And, you know, I just like to say, like, it was the brother B Wise that brought me in. It was the brother B Wise that suggested, you know, because two brothers fortunately left the prison, those original brothers that did the Belly of the Beast. So he was like, it might be a spot for you. So, you know, me and, you know, B Wise, I was introduced to B Wise, you know, by a brother, you know, a Muslim, because when I was in Trenton State Prison, you know, I was rapping then. So once I got transferred to Galway, sitting at the table where the Muslims sit at, oh, this is B-Wise, Latifah, blah, 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 blah. And, you know, that's how, like, I kind of, like, you know, became a part of this project, you know, which was, I wasn't with the Belly of the Beast. Those brothers, those original brothers, they did that. But once Living Proof came, and there was a lot of chaos that caused that. So, I appreciate, you know, B-Wise, you know what I mean, for, you know, bringing me in. I mean, we connected, and we was doing a lot of, you know, talent shows was happening. I mean, you know, the bankers and stuff like that. But, you know, it things happen. But I say now that, you know, we regroup, we're on the streets, we have better control, you know, over how we do this. And it's about networking, you know, how we can get this out and get this thing done right. And, you know, as you said, that project, Belly of the Beast, was Grammy nodded. You know, that's recognition from the industry. But nobody, we have our own lane. We got our own lane. I mean, we're not going to brag about being in prison, but if you want to say, like, you know, who's the thoroughest, you know, authentic rapper, who's most official, you know, who could be most efficient than a person that lived that life, went inside the prison, came back out, and doing it. Mm-hmm. You see, so I mean, we official for real, authentic, you know. But now it's from a professional perspective. We are right now in control of how we can do this. We can, we don't have to lock in. We can make these phone calls. We got cellular phones. We can connect, you know, with people who want to really, you know, get this message out. You know, it's not about preaching. It's about facts. I mean, you want to spit facts? We spitting facts. We spitting truth. You can't dispute that, and we're not gonna apologize. So, you know, we just put ourselves in this position and try to get it going. I mean, we're gonna do what we supposed to do.
And hold on for 1 second. And my suggestion, being as though we all on this call is, and being as though we all look alike, man, and you know, it's about growth as far as our people. I think both of you guys should do the documentary, man. You know what I mean? Because I think that both of you guys have beneficial, you know what I'm saying, perspective to bring. And we have a true-to-life story, you know what I mean? We're going to give you raw. Now, hold on. Let me tell you something. If you want, you know what I mean, something, you know what I mean, you know, beautiful or something like that, you're going to have to go to these boys that's only textbook. But if you want a real story, you know what I mean? That's gonna have you on your ass because it's a lot of things. You know what I'm saying? Popped off within this whole, you know what I mean, situation. You know what I mean? Like it wasn't just you come out here and you rap. You know what I mean? You know, boys was getting tested in that dog, and like if you couldn't rap, you was getting told straight up, nah, dog, or nah, you know what I mean? Your bars is trash or whatever. You know what I'm saying? Because we know each other, like we stuck together. You know what I mean? So. Either you was nice or you wasn't, you know what I mean? But if you want that true story, hook up with us, man. But I think both of you brothers should do it. You know what I mean? That's just my suggestion. I'm one.
Hey, I appreciate that. I hop back on because I realized I wasn't on my
That's
call.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
But I want to ask y'all, I want to ask y'all a question. This is a straight hip hop question. It's actually two. What's y'all favorite era of hip hop? If y'all could say 80s, 90s, 2000s, and then who would be y'all top five?
Good question.
Whoa. I'm saying me, yo, first of all, I'm a Sagittarius, bro. So, you know what I mean? We the type, don't ask us no questions because I'm going to tell the truth, you know what I mean, all the time. Me, myself, I think the best era was... I think all of us had a, you know what I mean, had a impact at different points in time, you know what I mean? Everybody made good points, you know what I mean? We ain't going to belittle nobody, but as far as, you know what I mean, like the people that you can understand and you can thoroughly get the message, you got to give it to the 90s, bro. You got to give it to the 90s. And as far as my top five, I'm saying, what you talking about? Bread or... Yeah, you know I mean,
I'm just talking about lyrically for you, just lyrically for you. Not no money, just lyrics, bars.
I'm gonna have to let Almighty Amazing G answer that. I'm gonna leave that on his, you know what I'm saying, lap. Then I'm gonna come back. You know what I'm gonna hear everybody else.
I got some top MCs, but I think it's to me. It's just more than five, you know. It's because I could go to Biggie, Jay, you know, Nas. I named my son after that boy. You know what I mean?
What's up with Jay, man?
Let me finish. Jada, me, Coogee Rap, KRS-One, yes. Big Daddy Kane, guys like that. So it's for me, it's more than just five. Yeah. You know what I mean? But, again, like El said, my era was like, for me, mid-80s, early 90s.
Go ahead, D-Wise, let me hear you.
And nah, man, because it's crazy, right? Because I wasn't rapping until I met my cousin. I ain't even noticed. talking about.
And then you go in and out, B-Wise.
Man. Who you? I know one of them that you like, but go ahead. I'm gonna let you say it. Stop playing with me.
And listen, it's more than five, man. The '90s all day. Fuji, yeah. Rap, Rakim, you know what I mean? MOP, right? Nas, right? Biggie, the big nose ball.
KRS-One?
No, Jay-Z, right? Jay-Z.
Nah, I'm disrespecting the homie, bro. That's
Nation, boy. Listen, you just got finished talking about the real, right? All right, yeah. And then you got the man. Yeah. And all that. Got a big nose.
But yeah, this Lottie Dot, and my top five, no doubt. Rakim, Big Daddy Kane. Cool G Rap. KRS-One got to go in there. And I want to say Nas, but I'm going to say Guru. Mm-hmm, in that era, the era that I like the most is the era where you couldn't sound like nobody else.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah. Where you couldn't come out. You had to have your own style. You had to have your 80s, own
early 90s, man. 80s, exactly. Early 90s.
Exactly. They call that the golden era. I mean, because hip hop still has something to prove. The music, you got to look at the music. You got to look, it was a hunger there. It was a hunger there. And that's like, I mean, that music, like, still today, get played for me. Like, this stuff that I be hearing now, some of I just can't stomach. I got to turn it. I know it's more, you know, it's more like a money thing situation like that. But that era where you had to sound like yourself, you couldn't come out sound like KRS-One. You couldn't you couldn't do that, and you had to have lyrics. So that's that golden era, which they call it.
I got my top five. I got my top five, man. My top five is Jay-Z, Biggie, Jada, Rosé, and Meek Mill.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So what about y'all?
Meek Mill.
I don't want to leave this. I don't want to leave this interview without letting folks know where they can get your new projects. I know you're working on the documentary. I'm humbled and honored. If y'all want me on it, me and Joe
definitely,
man.
No doubt. We got
Black Excellence, man. Black
we need
excellence.
Stuff that's certified.
Told you that the application is still available, brother.
All right, I'm ready.
We got the music and everything on smash. That documentary part, like I said, it's still open, brother. No, like I said, we could sit down, we could discuss this. You know, just hit us up, man. If you need to get our Gmails, I think you can get it from Kasim.
I got your emails.
All right, cool. Y'all
installed up. So
yo, hit us up. God loves the black sheep at gmail.com.
Let him speak. He was speaking. Go ahead, brother.
What new music project are you working on, and where can people right now, like, they're watching this interview, it's going to be up on you know, all over the internet, on YouTube,
it's definitely going to be out. We ain't dropped anything yet, but coming soon. Okay. Like I said, we're in the studios, and we got work that's already been completed. We just have to find out the release dates and things of that nature, but coming soon. Mm-hmm. And again, internet, YouTube, right, Twitter, Gmail, Instagram, all that. Life is Group Official, .com. We out there. We definitely out there. So you can definitely look us up.
The Real Life is Group Official on Instagram. The Real Life is Group Official on Instagram. We are like working on our page right now so that we can like plug our music into it and you can listen to it.
Right. And I want to say, like, the basic thing, what we're trying to do is have the documentary, but and do the soundtrack. That's what the music is for. We're recording that, so one go hand in hand. So the songs we're doing, it's going to have its release, but we intentionally want to make sure the songs we're doing, it's part of that soundtrack to the documentary.
We definitely gonna be releasing some singles. We gonna have something coming out probably this summer. You know what I mean? To keep everybody entertained to that documentary and that soundtrack actually drop. We're not gonna keep you waiting to the actual documentary. We're gonna give y'all something to go with. Okay. Keep y'all entertained till we drop that bomb.
Within the next couple weeks, whether it be a freestyle or whatever, and plus, like, we wanna let you guys know that we working with major, major producers, people like Vinny Idol, that's, you know what I'm saying, part of D-Block, Alchemist, and hot MCs, man. I mean, hot producers.
Violators.
oh yeah, violators. You know what I'm saying? So yeah, man. Yo, get with
Big Zay. Shout out to Big Zay. Shout out to Ralph Alvarez. Shout out to Gino. Shout out to them. All the brothers. We appreciate y'all working with us, man.
That's right.
And you too, brother. We appreciate you for bringing us on. You know what I mean? And letting us, you know, share our insight and our story on your platform. We appreciate that very much.
No problem. And I can tell you this, you know, and I can speak on behalf of Joe. Y'all always have a platform there. Anytime y'all.
Oh, Joe too. My bad. I forgot Joe. My bad, Joe. I don't got you in front of me. I apologize.
No problem, baby.
Anytime y'all come on this platform, Liberate Perspectives, Critical Insight, Your World News, and the Brew platform. You guys, listen, you got this platform to get your information out, because, and I'm going to say this, just honest, on the real, I see you all, and I, you know, Joe was like one of my best friends in the world. So, you know, when I say I could speak on it's because I know the brother well, and I believe he'll probably agree with me when I say this, is that some of the best educators are the ones on the streets, not the ones that got a bunch of letters behind their name.
That not a doubt.
Not to, you know, to disrespect them, but y'all are all educators. Almighty L, B Wise, Chuck X, you know, Rock D, Amazing, Merciful. Y'all are all educators. I mean, y'all have dropped knowledge on this interview, but even before that, y'all were dropping knowledge. And like I said, I was a kid. I was a kid when I got that tape cassette. And so I was
making us feel old.
Hey, yo, bro, look at the beauty. Bro, look at the beauty of God, man. They put us in the worst situations, right? And look, God is allowing us to use it to be one of the best situations for people. That's, you know, it. What I mean? Our pain, man, we are black roses, man. We got a story to tell, man. We can help people, save people lives from our pain, man. That's beauty, man.
No doubt.
Thanks.
No doubt. So with that, I want to thank y'all.
You know,
go on. I get
talked that. About you.
My sound just dropped. My sound just dropped, y'all.
It's all right.
Okay. We can hear you, though.
I can hear, but it's like dense. It got real low on me.
Right. Can you hear me?
Yeah, be wise. We can hear you.
Well, I can hear you.
Saying that, you know, we talked about the impact at one point, right? Yeah. That we see, you know, in making the album, you know, The Belly of the Beast, The Real Deal, The Lip Proof, right? You know, a lot of the impact was acknowledged when a lot of the fan mail that we was getting in the prison, right? And the people that was expressing how they appreciated what we was saying to the youth, you know what I'm saying? And to the people out there, then them asking us, is it really like this or is it really like that? You know, that's when we really knew, you know, about the impact that was being made. You know what I mean? And then when they came with this Grammy nod, it was like, oh, okay. You know, they really hear us. They really listening, right? Not to regress, but to go back.
That more good.
To go back.
That more good right there.
Back, like what G said, you know what I mean, about, you know, the first teachers in a child's life is his parents, right? Is his parents. So if the parents have a solid foundation, you know, white folks never raised our kids. We raised their kids. You know, back then, to raise their kids. But now, you know, they try to switch the script. And so this is why now the kids, you know, they're not raised and no discipline is in play, right? So it's crazy because addiction is a hell of a thing. So when you inflict an addiction in a society, whether that addiction be drugs, heroin, crack, you know what I mean, coke, meth, because for them white folks, it's meth. You know what I mean? Meth, like they crack. You know, crack did the most devastating damage to society to date. Crack. Not heroin. Not cocaine. Not meth. Crack in the 80s. Right? But who brought all that in here? Who supplied the ghetto? Who supplied all that? Right? So the thing is that addiction is a hell of a thing. But addiction is not just drugs. Addiction is feeling like you gotta take this money to survive. Addiction, this person,
to survive. Addiction is certain crimes, or you got to be so hard-headed that you don't want to listen to what is real, to what is true, until you actually go through it. Prison actually saved a lot of people, though. Just to get, you know, oxymoron. You got people with a dope because we be so close to, we be so close to the picture, we can't see the picture, right? It's like you know, you can't see the forest for the trees. Hey, some people, don't get me wrong, right? Because you stop. You got to listen to yourself. It's not so much listening to somebody else. Listen to yourself, the common sense that you have. Do you really want this person to tell you when you can take a shower or when you can't? You know, take a shit with you, right? So that's why some people, when they go into prison, they become Christians. Because they stop and they start reading. But they go to prison, they become Muslim, right? Stop. Or they become Afrocentric, because they stop and they start reading and they start listening. But why go through that? Our point is, why go through all that? When we can tell you how to get it before you even have to go through all that. Right. You know what I mean? So that's our point.
That will be that powerful. That's a powerful point to end on, that you've been listening to the Lifers Group. Please support these brothers. Please support their music, because their music and what they're doing is supporting our communities. And so I'm imploring folks that are watching right now to support these brothers, support their music, support the documentary.
Thanks.
Because like I said, it is supporting our people. It's supporting our communities.
Black excellence.
That's right. Black excellence all day, every day. I'm Tom John. That's my man JoJo, otherwise known as Dr. Joseph Richardson. And that's the life.
Thanks a lot, fellas.
No problem.
Appreciate it.
With journalism and activism, not mutually exclusive. Peace, brothers. Peace.
All right, peace.